Man, I love that. Can we watch that again? Just run that back. No, that's fantastic. Hey, this is usually the time you pass the register, but you are not allowed to pass the register right now, all right? This is the time we're going to get in God's Word. That's what we're going to do. We're changing up a little bit. Grab your Bibles. We're going to later on have an opportunity with announcements and register and offering. But right now, we want to turn our attention to the Word of God. And before we do that, I want to say this. Can I just say this to all of you? Merry Christmas, Harvest. I love Christmas. This is like the best time of year. I'm in for the whole package. Package, you get it? I love the Christmas trees. I love the lights. I love the decor. I love the music. Didn't we not sing familiar songs today with Christmas lyrics? Is that not what happened? I love that. That was fantastic. Let's do more of that. I was talking with a friend last night. He says, we should do Christmas year-round. I was like, well, I feel like we'd lose something if we did that, but I do love the Christmas season. I am actually personally quite a fan of the good meals and treats that come this time of year. I love the special gatherings, the parties, the cookie exchange, the concert. I love that schedules get changed and we spend more time doing things together. I hope that's happening for you. I hope that you're enjoying that. But I gotta say, more than anything else, hands down, best part of Christmas, it's all about Jesus Christ. It is all about the birth of Jesus Christ and the miraculous way in which God chose to do that. I want to enjoy all the things of Christmas, but if we miss that, we miss it all. So I want us to be careful that we're not just running through a month of activities and baking and buying and giving and receiving and singing without actually leaning into, again, or maybe for the first time, the reality of who Jesus Christ is and what God did in giving us Jesus as a baby. If we're not careful, all those extra gatherings can lead us into decisions, whether they're related to calories or dollars, of overdoing it. And then we'll have to make a resolution in a couple weeks to fix it. Let's not do that. But let's focus in on Jesus Christ, our hope, our Savior, the Prince of Peace, the Promised One who came. Now, I'm going to just go out on a limb here and say that I'll bet everyone in here has heard the Christmas story. And I would guess that the vast majority of you have or will be reading Luke chapter 2 over the last weeks or the weeks to come. I hope you will. I want us to come at it today with a fresh perspective. I don't want this, my prayer for this time would be this, that it would not just be merely familiar, but it would be fresh for you and for me. I pray that this would not be merely sentimental, oh, Merry Christmas, but it would be deeply personal to you and to me. Not some historic and distant story, but here and now and real to us again. Not harried or hurried. Do you feel that way at Christmas sometimes? Lord, help us. But instead, pondering and receiving and responding and sharing who Jesus Christ is. Lord, keep us from a passive mental agreement to what we hear and help us lean into personal reflection and response of the story of Christmas of Jesus Christ. That's my hope. That's my prayer. So let's pray about that together, and then we're going to jump in. Heavenly Father, it is an awesome thing to be with your people, to be in your house, to sing the songs that are true of who you are. Now, Lord, we hold in our hands your very word. Thank you for your word. Would you use it in this time now, Lord, to point our hearts, to draw our hearts and our minds more closely to you. We love you, Lord, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, Luke chapter 2. Now, we were going to focus in on verses 8 through 21. That's where we're going to spend most of our time today. But you really can't start in 8 without reading verse 1. All right, that's the whole story, and then the rest is what happens after. So let me start reading in Luke chapter 2, verse 1. Lord, help us hear it with hearts that are ready to receive. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. This is the story. This is the story of stories. And I think it's fascinating to read it again and to look at it with fresh eyes. What exactly was happening here? Why would Joseph and Mary go from Nazareth to Bethlehem? Well, there was a census. It was decreed. This is the order of the land. You must go to the place where your family tree is from and be counted. You're a part of this census. Joseph had no option. I'm going to Bethlehem. Interesting to me is that he would go with Mary. Bethlehem to Nazareth is approximately 90 miles. And my wife, I remember when she was pregnant with each of the kids and close to delivering, road trips were not the best. Right, ladies? Road trips without a minivan at that time or without paved roads were probably not great. And here's Joseph and Mary making this trek, 90-ish miles. By the way, 90 miles would just be, if you want to go for a walk this afternoon, head to Milwaukee or Kankakee. No, thank you. Definitely not so interested if you're about to have a baby. And this is what the Lord did. Now, why did that happen? I don't really understand exactly why. Maybe Joseph felt that this is my betrothed Mary. By the way, betrothed is more than engaged. Engaged is, will you? Yes, I will. Okay, we'll set a date. It's coming. Betrothed was actually a legal connection, a legal commitment. So it's more than that. They're not married, but this is done. They're in it together. Did Joseph, was he concerned for her well-being? Quite possibly. Was he concerned for her in the climate of her hometown where this unmarried woman is about to have a baby? What was that like? I don't know. I don't know exactly why God did it this way. On the other hand, I know exactly why God did it this way, because this is what he said he was going to do. In Micah 5:2 in the Old Testament, Micah 5:2 says this, "From you, Bethlehem, will come one who is to be ruler in Israel." Why, Lord, did you do it like that? Because he said he was going to do it like that. He said the Savior of the world, the ruler, was going to be born in Bethlehem. Micah wrote that approximately 700 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. When God says it, it's going to happen. So they're there. They're in Bethlehem. That's the house and lineage of David. He came from the line of King David, Joseph did. Mary was what? What's it say about Mary? She was with child. She's pregnant. That's very obvious from the story. I'm not sure the exact timing when they traveled in terms of her pregnancy, but while she was there in Bethlehem, the time came to give birth to this baby, Jesus. It was a long time coming. A 90-mile walking road trip while pregnant is a long time coming. Yes, ladies? I'll take your word for it. 9 months is a long time coming. Most women I know who are close to ready to deliver, they're like, it's time. But it's more than that. 400 years, do you know this? From the end of the Old Testament to the beginning of the Gospels, 400 years of silence from the revelation of God. 400 years is a long time coming. And here comes the birth of Jesus. Even more than that, do you know that in Genesis, when Adam and Eve sinned and there were consequences, the fall, do you know there's a promise in Genesis chapter 3, 15, verse 15, that God will provide a way of salvation? This was a long time coming, and here it comes, Jesus, the Son of God. A couple of other details. He will be in swaddling cloths. He had swaddling cloths. That's loving parents caring for their child. In a manger, the King of Kings the Lord of Lords being born, not in Jerusalem, not in the palace, not in the temple, in Bethlehem, in a barn, in a manger. Humility. Our Lord came in humility, and there was no room for him in the inn. Apparently, circumstances in Bethlehem were such that there was no place for them to go, and apparently no one taking them in. So they found a place on their own in a manger, in a stable. All this is a backdrop for where we're going today. So let me keep reading. Luke chapter 2, verse 8 says this, "And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them. And the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger.'" All right, what's happening here? Well, there's shepherds out in the field. What in the world are the shepherds doing in the field? Working. That was their job. I punched the time clock. I've got the night shift. That's the one in the dark. That's the one when the wild animals come. They're doing their job. They're on their task. They're providing for their families, probably. They were focused on the task at hand and then completely interrupted. Surprisingly, divinely interrupted. Shepherds on the night shift fending off the wild animals. Are these guys who are easily scared? I would go with no. I think these are manly men who know how to take care of business. And in the middle of the night, in their shift, in the dark, something happens. What happened? An angel of the Lord, verse 9, appeared to them. The glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. Now, I don't know what you think of if I said, hey, draw me a picture of an angel. What's an angel look like? Or show me a picture. Here's some things we might see. I don't think this guy looked like that. Not feeling great fear, are you? Probably not like this either. That's nice, but that's not the picture here. There's one more like this. Yeah, none of those. That's not who showed up. Do you know that in Scripture, when an angel appears with a message from the Lord, do you know what the most common reaction is? Fear and getting on your face. This is a messenger, an angel, the same word is used, angel, messenger of the Lord. And these manly men were not a little bit afraid. What does it say? They were filled with great fear. Very kind of the angel to then say this, "Fear not. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." And that's our point here. The first point is this. This is a message for all. The birth of Jesus Christ, the arrival of God's Son, is a message for all. It is a message for me. It's a message for you and every person sitting in this room. It's a message for every person who wouldn't think of coming to sit in this room today. God's word tells us that there's good news of great joy for all. I love that. Every person you can think of, this is good news, can be the best news ever for them. I was thinking a little bit about news. Do you follow the news? Did you follow the news? Do you read the news? Did you see the news this morning? I was laughing with a lady last night. She was upset because her Sunday paper didn't come yesterday. She called. They told her it was Saturday, so it all worked out. But, you know, you want to see the news, right? What's going on in the news? What's happening? Feels like the news is nonstop. Just, you turn the TV on, well, there's the news, there it is. You listen to the radio, well, I was going to listen to the ball game, but now they're telling me the news, and maybe you have an app on your phone. That's your own fault if you did that. We get a lot of news. My friends tell me news. I get emails, I get texts, I get phone calls, social media tells me stuff. News, 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 news. What's happening somewhere else? What's happening somewhere else? I got to get the news. There's lots of different kinds of news. Do you realize that? Here's a couple of categories. There's bad news. Bad news. You get bad news? I get bad news. Bad news. Here's some bad news. Taxes are going up. Did you hear that? Well, I didn't actually hear that. I just assumed that. I think that's going to, they don't seem to go down. On a serious note, a volcano in New Zealand this week, people lost their lives. That's bad news. I had a friend this week from one of our campuses in a very significant car accident on the way to work on I-90. That was not good news to hear. He's doing okay. A lot of people in our church have lost loved ones recently, and it's bad news. It hurts. The doctor says more tests. We're not sure. We need to talk about this. This is real for a lot of people. I'm out of work. I don't have a job. I need a job. I need to provide for my family. Bad news. Sometimes news is bad news. Sometimes news is like this. That's good news for you. Well, that's good news for you. Like, you got the job, the promotion. Congratulations. Good for you. Or you're expecting a baby. That's good for you. Or you're engaged. Fantastic. Congratulations. Or you're vacationing in Hawaii. Good for you. Oh, you're moving to Hawaii. Oh, good for you. You know, there's good for you. But then that's good news for me. That's another category, right? That's good news for me. Things like this. My kids are doing well. They're turning towards the Lord. They're working hard. They're seeing good things in their life. That's good for me. The doctor gave a good report. Thank you, Lord. That's good for me. My boss said thank you. Good job. Well, that's good for me. Then there's this category. There's good news. That's good news for some. Let me give you an example of this one. That person, my candidate, won the election. Yeah, but that wasn't my candidate. Okay, right? Like sometimes there's a lot of perspectives on these things, and we don't always agree. Here's the one. Black Friday deals were amazing this year. Man, I made a killing. I was out all night. Yeah, but I work retail, and I was working all night for Black Friday. That wasn't awesome. It's good news for some. Or those cookies are amazing, but I'm on a diet, right? Depends on your perspective. All right, listen, I say all this to say this. Scripture tells us that the message the angels brought to the shepherds was what? Good news of great joy for who? For all. This is a message for all. Good news. I like good news. In fact, as a pastor, you don't always get good news. Sometimes you get hard news. And I am thankful for the opportunity we have to point people to the Lord. He's the source of hope and comfort and life. But I had a friend this week text me, and he said, do you have a minute to talk? Nothing bad. And I was like, I called him immediately. I was like, what's going on? So listen, good news of great joy for all. Jesus is born. Now, what kind of people is this for? Is this for the religious people? Yeah, for sure it's good news for them. What about for the unreligious people? Yes, good news for them too. What about, was this for the people in Israel? Yep, definitely. Was this for the people outside of Israel? Yes. How about people who got to see with their own eyes? Yeah, it's for them. What about the ones who weren't there, like you and me, who've heard about it from somebody else? Yeah, it's for us too. What about the proud people? Is it good news for them? Yeah, it is. What about for failing people? It's good news, guys. What about for broken or hurting or confused people? The birth of Jesus Christ is good news and great joy for all. What about rebellious or stubborn people? What about prodigal people? Yeah. The good news of Jesus Christ is for all, a message for all. Right here outside Bethlehem to very ordinary people, shepherds. They were not looking for this, but God met them and he interrupted and he told them, I'm doing something new. God sent messengers to announce the arrival of the Savior. Unto you is born this day a Savior, Christ the Lord. Thank you, Lord, a message for all. And he says, this is going to be a sign for you, a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. So now these shepherds, they receive this message. They're probably, their pulse is now back to a normal rate, maybe. And then what happens? Look at verse 13. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God. Now, wait a second. I'm out here in the dark. One angel filled me with great fear. Now, there's a bunch of them, a host, an army of these angels, messengers of God. I think that's a good time to listen. Do you think that's a good time to listen? What did they say? Saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased. This is a message for all, but it's also this. It's a peace to receive. It's a peace to receive. Have you received it? Let me talk about this a little bit more. I got to tell you that as I observe people, this one, the ones who are close to me, the ones in our community, the ones in the world, there is so often an absence of peace. There is fear, there is anxiety, there is uncertainty, there is stress, there is striving, there's wrestling, but there's so rare to find true peace, the peace of the Lord in people's lives. But you know he offers it to us? I think we're so prone to go the wrong direction with this. And I wrote down, and you could come up with other ones, but here's a couple of false paths we take to peace. I think that if I can get this one going, I'm going to find true peace in my soul, in my heart, in my mind. Here's one of the false paths. Security, I put that in quotes on purpose, security of circumstances. Hey, I'm all good. My job is good. My home is good. My health is good. Everything's working out. And as long as those things are good, I'm good. Okay? If I can build enough of a fortress, then I'm safe. I'm secure. Well, I'm not against you doing any of those things, but our ultimate security can't be found in our circumstances. It can only be found in Christ. Here's another false path to peace: safety of relationships. Well, I am good as long as I have that relationship. As long as that's going good, I'm good. I can't be okay until I have that in a good place. I am incomplete until I find, or until I have, or until, and we have to be so careful. Lord, thank you for our relationships, but I can't put my safety in them. My hope is in the Lord. Here's another false path. Satisfaction in achievements. Do you like to get stuff done? I like to get stuff done too. And there should be a measure of satisfaction, but if my ultimate satisfaction is in my accomplishment, I did this, I did that, I met the goal, I hit the quota, I finished the degree, those aren't evil things, but they are not the source of peace. They will not sustain your soul. Here's another one, the illusion of control. This one hit me last summer. I have daughters, and one of them decided to go on a trip outside the country. And I was like, well, the problem with that is when she's out of the country, I don't have control. Newsflash, you never did. You think that you can set something up in such a way that you're controlling the circumstances. You can't. The illusion of control. God is in control. Peace is found in bringing these things to Jesus. And then one more false path is this: comfort in substances. This can be a big deal. I am peaceful when I can get that food or that beverage or too much of those things or seeking drugs or something to help me escape. I just need, it's all got to go behind me and I have to, those things won't satisfy you. There is peace and it is found in Jesus Christ. What is peace? Peace is a settled confidence that God is real, God is near, God is in control, and God is good. Peace is not determined by my circumstances, but it's found in the presence of my God in the midst of my circumstances. Let me say it this way. Peace is not found in the absence of pain, struggle, or uncertainty, but is only found in the presence of the Prince of Peace, Jesus. Can I say that again? Peace is not found in the absence of pain, struggle, or uncertainty, but is only found in the presence of the Prince of Peace, Jesus. I just want to ask you, where is peace absent in your life today? Don't get me started on that topic, that relationship, that thing, that uncertainty, that struggle, that difficult, that disappointment. Do you know that God offers peace to all of us in His Son, Jesus Christ? And the Prince of Peace arrives, as this story tells us. So then the question is this, are you going to receive it? Are you going to receive it? These shepherds now, they've got an option, right? I don't know. Did you hear anything? I didn't hear anything. Do you think that was just lightning? Maybe. No, I don't think that was lightning. But when you hear something, you have choices to make. And receiving is more than just hearing. I think it requires hearing, it requires receiving, and it requires responding. Okay? If you're really going to receive truth, and this is a message from the Lord delivered miraculously, if you're going to receive this, you have to hear it. Not just hear it, but absorb it. And to receive it is to say, that is true. That is right. That is good. I accept that to be true. Then what? To respond. If we are not responding to the messages the Lord gives to us, what are we doing? To hear, to receive, and then what? To respond. Do you think these shepherds responded? What do you think? Yeah, I'm thankful they did. Look at verse 15. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." I love this. The shepherds are like, for sure something happened. What now? We're going to Bethlehem now. That's what we're doing. God gave me a message. I heard it. I receive it to be true, and it's time to act. That's really a beautiful thought. Think about this. God speaks to us, does He not? He speaks to us through His Word. And then I have to ask myself, but am I reading it? Am I hearing it? Further, am I receiving it to be His very Word for me? And it doesn't mean much until it moves into response. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I will do what you're telling me to do. Responding. We have daily choices that we make to hear, to receive, to respond. And this peace of the Lord is like that. Will you receive it? Will you take the thing that is so big to you and not so big to the Lord and entrust it to Him and draw near to Him? Because when you do, He promises peace. It's a message for all. It's a peace to receive, and it's a choice to treasure. It's a choice to treasure. Now, if God sends you a message, what would be the best time to respond to that message? Well, I'm a little busy right now, but how about right now? How about right now? If the Lord gives you something and tells you something to do, the time to respond is now. I think the shepherds totally get this. Because look at verse 16. And they went with what? Haste. What is the proper way to obey? With haste. Right now. That's a good word for me, for sure, and for all of us. And what did they find? Well, can we just pause for a second? At my house growing up, when all the presents were ready and under the tree and all the kids were overly eager to open them, there was always a point when mom or dad would say, well, before we open the presents, we're going to read Luke chapter 2. To which I would say, who is the fastest reader in our family? And this verse, I got to tell you, this verse has a problem if you read it too fast. Here's how I used to hear it. Verse 16. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And I was always like, that is a big manger. Joseph and Mary and the baby. You're not really tracking with me. It's okay. Commas are helpful. They went with haste and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. This sounds like what they had been told, doesn't it? Let's see. Baby, check. Swaddling cloths, check. Manger, check. What are the odds? The odds are 100% if the Lord says it. He sent them a message, and it is exactly what he said. And Mary, what did she do? Verse 19, but Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. Mary did know, because she had been visited by an angel who said, you're going to conceive a child of the Holy Spirit as a virgin, and you're going to name him Jesus. It wasn't unclear to Mary. She knew exactly what happened. But do you ever have this experience where you're like, I know that's true, but the more time that goes from the time I heard that, I'm tempted to get distracted or maybe not believe or maybe get fearful. I'm not sure exactly what was happening there, but I think it's kind of a cool grace of the Lord what's about to happen. Because God went to the shepherds to tell them, and he's got a mission for them, but Mary is pondering these things. This is God's son. He is going to provide all that's needed. His will be accomplished. It's beautiful. Mary knew. But here's a divine confirmation about to come. Now, a couple of years ago in our church, we showed the movie The Shepherd. Some of you might remember this at Christmas time. And it's a movie that's made, produced, directed by Dallas Jenkins, who's a part of our church family. In preparing and reading and wanting to come at this with fresh eyes this week, one of our pastors reminded me of that. And I watched some. I'm like, we have to see this. So we're going to watch part of that right now. Let's watch this.
And shall call his name Emmanuel.
So beautiful.
We must tell someone.
We must tell everyone.
We must tell everyone.
Everyone. Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
We've waited for this for so long. So long.
His arm. His arm.
His arm.
His arm.
Yes, his arm.
Oh, it's okay. Will you name him?
Jesus.
We will name him Jesus. I must go. People must know. People must know.
People must know.
Pray we come to the very familiar with a fresh response. This is a message for all, and it's a peace to receive, and it's a choice to treasure. I'm convicted personally. I don't always treasure the beauty of what God did in giving his son, Jesus, but let that change in us, that we would be humble and receiving and honoring him for the gift he gave. And then I would just add to this, not just treasure, but treasure and tell. I love those shepherds. Somebody must know. Everyone must know. We must go. They could not tell about what had happened. That needs to be true of me. That needs to be true of you. What God has done for me, I did not deserve it. I did not earn it. I never could. He offered a gift, a savior, hope, salvation, forgiveness. Will you receive it? And will you receive it again today by faith, treasuring what he's done for us, and tell it? Lord, help us be like the shepherds. Tell it. And then there's this last part. Not only is it all those things, it's also this, a reason to praise. A reason to praise. Look at verse 20. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. What are they going to do? They're going to praise God is what they're going to do. They're going to have fervency of worship in honoring him with their lives because God has revealed something to them, that a Savior is born, Jesus Christ, the Lord. What did they do? They heard it, they received it, and they responded. And I would just call you to the exact same things today. Don't hear it just with your ears, but with your heart and with your soul. Don't receive it as, oh, it's time for that story again, but as, Lord, what a treasure you gave us, your son, Jesus Christ, and then respond. Respond in worship. Respond in submission. If you have never yet responded to Jesus Christ by faith, please let it be today. I would love to talk to you about that and tell you about what Jesus Christ has done for us. And the passage finishes, at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. I hope you're not just listening, but you're looking for where you are in this story. You know, Mary and Joseph were given a divine mission, and they accepted it by faith, and they trusted that God was doing something that they wanted to be a part of. That could be us, Lord. Help us to be faithful with the thing you give to us. Unto Bethlehem. Here's a little city that, unaware, unconcerned, uninterested, apparently, in what was happening right in their midst. Don't let that be me. Lord, I want to be in to whatever you're doing and responding to what you're doing. Unto shepherds. Their reality was interrupted in a moment. They were not searching for him. They were not looking for the Savior, but they heard and they received and they responded. Unto all. They went and told. They were listening, they were marveling, but they didn't quite know what to make of it, some of them. Here it is, guys. Unto you. How will you respond to the Lord today? Maybe it's a first-time decision of faith. Maybe it's a fervency of, I got to go tell somebody about who Jesus is and what he's done. What a perfect time of year to do that. Maybe it's treasuring again what he's done for us today. Let the Lord lead us and let us be people who respond to him with haste. Good news of great joy for all. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your truth. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your perfect and divine timing. Lord, at the perfect time, you fulfilled your word exactly as you said it, and you always do, and you always will. So Lord, let us be people who respond to you by faith, not merely hearing, but receiving, responding to you. Lord, I pray for people today who need to give their life to Jesus Christ. No more waiting, no more debating, no more wondering. Thank you, Lord, this message is for all. I pray for many of us who need to hear this again for the first time and to put it into practice in our lives. Let us be those who would go and tell. Lord, Jesus Christ is everything to us. We praise and worship you at Christmas. Let it be the truth that motivates and fuels our faith year-round. We love you, Lord. We commit this to you. You are exalted over all. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Amen.